Hello everyone, welcome back. In this lecture, we will be discussing about direct band gap and indirect band gap semiconductors. Let us start. So before going into the direct and indirect band gap semiconductors, I would like to classify the materials based on the band gap. As you can see here, this is the valency band and this is the conduction band. And this is increasing energy side. That means the valency band is lower energy and the conduction band is bit higher energy. And the difference between the valency band maximum, this is the EV, and then this is the EC, that means the bottom of the conduction band. The difference between the EC and EV is called band gap. That is represented as EG. Now, this is the band gap of the material. If the band gap of the materials is greater than 3 electron volt or larger, then we can say those materials are called insulators. And if you see here, there is another type of materials where the band gap, this is the band gap here, and this is a valence band and this is a conduction band of the semiconductors. If you can see here, the band gap of the semiconductors is smaller compared to insulators, but still there exists a band gap. So these kind of materials are called semiconductors. In this case, the band gap energy is of the order of 1 electron volt. So that means if the material whose band gaps are lies around 1 electron volt, then we can say they are semiconductors. And in another case, if you see here, in this case, this is the valency band and now if you see here, this is the conduction band. You can see here, in this case, the valency band and the conduction band are overlapping each other at some portion. This is the overlapping portion. So that means there is no band gap. These kind of materials are called conductors or metals. So here, the valency band and conduction band overlaps each other. Now if you see here, in this case, because the valency band is already having electrons. Now the valency band is already having some electrons. Since there is no band gap in this case, in the case of conductors or metals, now all these electrons will be easily getting to the conduction band and participate into the conduction process. So we don't need to apply any external energy to send electrons into the conduction band to have a conduction process. That is the reason why the metals or conductors will have a high conductivity of the order of 10 power minus 6 ohm meter. That means resistivity. When you compare with the conductors, you can see here in the case of insulators. In the case of insulators, the band gap is too high. Now, all the electrons in the valency band are the valency band is full of electrons. The valency band is completely filled with electrons in the case of insulators. Now, if you wanted to have a conduction in the insulators, we need to apply a lot of energy to send these electrons to conduction band. However, it is very difficult to apply a lot of energy to send these electrons to conduction band. Though this is a 3 electron volts, but when we apply 3 electron volts, there is a huge number of electrons are in the valency band. All these electrons will disperse the energy and then adjust themselves so that the energy which is getting by one electron is very less. So consequently, the electrons cannot jump into the conduction band. So since the band gap is very high, so the electrons in the valency band cannot be pumped to conduction band. Obviously, there is no conduction in the case of insulators. Whereas in the case of semiconductors, if you see, the band gap is very small, 1 electron volt. Now, normally, the semiconductors at 0 Kelvin, all the valence band is completely filled and there is no electrons in the conduction band. This is how the valence band is completely filled. Now, at room temperature, that means the temperature T not equal to 0 Kelvin, what happens is, at room temperature itself, sufficiently enough thermal energy is available. Now, these electrons, some of the electrons gains energy from the room temperature energy and crosses this band gap and goes into conduction band. Now, at room temperature, we can see sometimes there will be some of the electrons will be populated into the conduction band. So, now the conduction band is partially filled and valency band is also partially filled. At T is equal to 0 Kelvin, there is no electrons in the conduction band and the valency band is completely filled. That is the reason why the conductors at T is equal to, semiconductors at T is equal to 0 Kelvin or close to 0 Kelvin acts like a perfect insulators. In the case of insulators, there is no electrons in the conduction band. That is the reason why they are not conducting. Similarly, at T is equal to 0 Kelvin, semiconductors also cannot conduct. That's the reason, that's why we can say semiconductors at T is equal to 0 Kelvin acts as insulators. However, at T not equal to 0 Kelvin, that means 300 Kelvin room temperature, some of the electrons can gain energy from the heat energy, room temperature energy can go to conduction band. Now the conduction band is partially filled. Now under application of electric field, there is small number of electrons and small number of holes present in the valence band can give a moderate conductivities. Whereas in the case of metals, we don't need to apply any temperature since there is a valence band and conduction band are overlapping each other. So there is enough number of electrons are in the valence band which can excite into conduction band automatically, can participate in the conduction. That is the reason why metals will have a larger conductivities. Semiconductors will have a moderate conductivities or lies between metals and insulators because they can be excited very easily. In the case of insulators, we cannot excite electrons across the band gap. Now, what happens when electron is actually de-exciting from conduction band to valence band? That means when electron is de-exciting from conduction band to valence band, that means it is reaching to hole. What happens? You can see here, this is the electron and this is a hole. When electron is actually de-exciting to hole, that means electron is recombining with a hole, it releases energy. That means whenever an electron is jumping from higher energy level to lower energy level, it releases energy in the form of photons. You can see here, this is called a recombination process. Like this way, electron will recombine with a hole and produce a electromagnetic radiation. This is called electron hole pair recombination. And the emitted photon energy E is equal to E2 minus E1, that is EC minus EB, which is equal to EG. That means emitted photon will have a energy which is equal to the band gap energy. Now, in this bands, the electrons are moving. So, let us consider electron is a particle which has a mass and moving with velocity v. Now, we can write the momentum of the electron is mv. This is classically we can write the momentum of the electron mass into velocity. However, the electron is a quantum particle. When electron is revolving around the nucleus and moving in the conductor, it moves very high velocities. So it acquires a quantum behavior. So when the particle is in quantum behavior, we can write its momentum p is equal to h cut k, where h cut is h by 2 pi, that is a Planck's constant. This is also called as reduced Planck's constant, and k is momentum vector. H cut k. Momentum of the quantum particle is h cut k. Now we also know that the energy of the particle is E is equal to p square by 2m. Now when we combine this classical particle in terms of its quantum behavior, that means wave particle behavior, we can write this p in terms of quantum momentum, that is h cut square k square by 2m. That is the energy of the particle. That means energy of the electron. Now if you see here, h cut is a reduced Planck's constant, that is a constant. M is the mass of the electron, that is also constant. So we can simply write E is equal to some constant A into k square. Now you can see here, that means energy of the particle, that means energy of the electron is look like a parabola, because E is directly proportional to K square. That's a equation for the parabola. That means the energy of the electron will look like a kind of parabola. Similarly, for the energy of the hole is also look like a parabola, but it will be inverted. We can draw the energy of the system in this way. This is the momentum. This is the momentum versus energy. So here this is the energy of the particle. We always represent energy. This is valency band and conduction band. So in this energy expression, somewhere we will have, this is the EV, that's a valency band energy, that valency band H. This is conduction band H. Now, however, if you see here, the energy of the electron is in the form of parabola. That means the parabola look like this way. For the hole, the parabola looks like this way. And for the electron, the parabola look like this way. Now this is increasing energy side. So actually the band diagram looks like this way, not the one that we are showing like this way or like this way. Actual band diagram in the case of materials or semiconductors looks like this way. It won't be a flat, it will be kind of a parabolic in nature. And now here, this is the maximum of the band, valency band, that's called EV. And then this is the minimum of the conduction band, that we say EC. Now, whenever electron is jumping from conduction band to valency band, it releases energy E in the form of H nu, which is equal to band gap energy. This is how we represent the band diagram. Now, why we are discussing all these things? Now, the question is, now here the interesting thing is, when our electron is de-exciting from higher energy level to lower energy level, there are two things must happen. That is, the first one is, its energy should be conserved. It has to follow energy conservation law, and its momentum also should be conserved. That means whenever electron is taking a transition from higher energy level to lower energy level, its energy should be conserved, momentum also should be conserved. Now we will see in some certain cases what happens. If you see here in this particular case where this is the conduction band and this is the valency band. And if you see here, this is the valency band edge EV, this is the conduction band edge EC. Now, this is actually the K axis, the momentum axis, this is energy axis. Now, if you see here, when our electron is taking a transition in this kind of band diagram, that means in this kind of materials, now let's see the energy here. The difference between EC and EV is, that is band gap. Now, when our electron is jumping from this kind, from here to here, we can write the emitted energy E is equal to EC minus EV is equal to H nu. This is the, this, that means it is equal to EC minus EV called band gap, which is equal to H nu. This means energy, conservation of energy is satisfied. Let us also see the momentum conservation. In the momentum conservation, you can see this is the momentum axis. And when our electron is transferring from here to here, actually, it is transferring from the same momentum from here to here. There is no change in the K value. That means whenever the electron is transferring from this kind of band to here, that means in the same K value, then that means K minus K is equal to 0. That means electron before transition K and electron after transition K, that means K minus K is equal to 0. That means conservation of momentum also satisfied. In this kind of bands,
whenever an electron is jumping from higher energy level to lower energy level, we get a photon. We get a photon which is exactly equal to the band gap of the material. This kind of materials are called direct band gap materials. Direct band gap materials. However, there is another type of materials where you can see here. Now, in this case, this is the axis, this is a momentum axis, and this is the energy axis here. Now, this is the valency band and this is the conduction band. Can you find where is the band gap? Is this the band gap? Is this the band gap? No, this is not the band gap, because the band gap means the difference between the top of the valency band, energy difference between the top of the valency band to the bottom of the conduction band, that is actually the band gap. Can you find out the top of the valency band? This is the top of the valency band. That is the reason why we can say this is EV. What is the bottom of the conduction band? Is this the bottom of the conduction band? Can you see here? Again, here there is a band. The conduction band is still here, and the bottom of this conduction band is lies here, not here. So that means this is the bottom of the conduction band. Now, if you see here, the energy band gap is here, actually the difference between EC minus EV. This is the band gap, not this one. Now, in this kind of materials, now if you see, whenever electron is transferring from here, this is the bottom of the conduction band, to the top of the valency band, it has to satisfy both momentum and energy. Let us see the energy part. Now, since you can see here, the energy, that is EC minus EV is equal to EG. However, when you see the momentum, see for example, this is the momentum of the momentum of the electron before transition. The momentum of the electron before transition is, so let's consider this is a K2, and the momentum of the electron after transition, let's consider K1, because this K axis is spread across this length. So if the valency band top is a K1, then K2, the conduction band minimum, is actually coming after this. So let's consider this is a K2. Now let's write the conservation of momentum for this transition. That is, before starting the momentum of the electron, K2 minus K1 is not equal to zero. Is not equal to zero, because K2 minus K1 is not equal to zero. But in the case of here, both are same K value, so they both cancels each other. But in this case, K2 is different, K1 is different. K2 minus K1 is not equal to zero. That means in this kind of band diagram, the conservation of momentum is not going to satisfy. That means whenever electron is transferring from this band, kind of bands, the conservation of momentum will not satisfy. So in order to satisfy the conservation of momentum, what actually material does is, it creates another particle called phonon with the momentum which is equal to K2 minus K1. With the momentum which is equal to K2 minus K1 is equal to H omega. So now if you see the conservation of momentum, K2 minus K1 is equal to omega. That is the frequency come momentum, or you can consider the momentum of the photon is k dash. That means in order to conserve the momentum of the system, the material creates or absorbs another particle. That particle is called phonon. Phonon means collective lattice vibrations is called phonon. You'll understand this little bit more detailed. So in this way, in this kind of transitions, we will also have, along with photon, we will also have a phonons. Let's see more details. In the direct band gap semiconductors, as shown in the figure, the minimum of the conduction band and the maximum of the valency band appears at the same wave vector. So here, if you see, this is the one wave vector, and the
This is the top of the valency band, this is the bottom of the conduction band. They both appear at the same k wave vector. So the transition of electrons will not have to follow any other things. So the transition of electrons will have a conservation of momentum easily. So in the direct band of semiconductors, both energy and moment of the electrons will be conserved. So in this case, the electrons, whenever transition is taking place in the case of direct band of semiconductors, both energy and momentum will be conserved easily. In the direct band of semiconductors, an electron from the conduction band can recombine with a hole in the valency band directly by emitting a photon of energy which is equal to band gap energy. We have already discussed, whenever an electron is jumping from here to here, it emits a photon which is equal to h nu. So that means in the case of direct band of semiconductors, the photons will be emitted very easily because conservation of momentum, conservation of energy takes place. The lifetime of the charge carriers is less in the case of direct band of semiconductors because the conservation of momentum and conservation of energy takes place easily. So electrons no need to stay longer time in the higher energy levels. These are mostly from compound semiconductors, like example gallium arsenide and indium phosphides. These kind of band gaps will appear in the compound semiconductors like gallium arsenide and indium phosphide. These are used in the LEDs and laser diodes. As you can see, whenever you wanted to get a photon, we always should have a direct band gap semiconductors, because in the case of direct band gap semiconductors, the energy and momentum will be conserved directly. So the photon will emit with energy which is equal to band gap energy. So in the case of light emitting diode and lasers, we require a light to be emitted. That is the reason why we always choose a direct band gap semiconductors when we wanted to prepare LEDs or laser diodes. Now in the case of indirect band gap semiconductors, you can see here, as shown in the figure, the minimum of the conduction band and the maximum of the conduction band appears at different k values. You can see here, this is the k axis, this is the top of the valency band appearing at different k, and this is the bottom of the conduction band appearing at different k values. This is a k2. That means conservation of momentum will not satisfy. In this, the momentum of the electrons will not be conserved because of the different k values. That means the top of the valency band and bottom of the conduction band appearing at different k value. So the conservation of momentum will not satisfy. In order to conserve the momentum of electron, photons will be created or absorbed in the material. So whenever electron is transferring from here to here, that means bottom of the conduction band to the top of the valency band, along with the photon, there will be another particles called phonons will be created or absorbed, depends upon the situation. In indirect band of semiconductor, an electron from a conduction band can recombine with a hole in the valency band by creating or annihilating phonons. This is what we discussed. Here there is no emission of light photons, but there is emission of phonon leading to a rise of material temperature. That's what here. The important thing is, whenever electron is jumping from this kind of semiconductor, indirect band of semiconductor, the photons won't be emitted much. However, the phonons will be emitted. These phonons means, the phonon means collective lattice vibrations. Collective lattice vibrations is called a phonon. Quantum of lattice vibrations is called phonon. Lattice vibrations means simply heat. It will generate a lot of heat. So whenever electron is transferring from this kind of material from conduction band to valence band, it leads to either producing heat or absorbing heat. The phonons means it's a kind of heat. It's a kind of heat. So whenever phonon is creating, that means it heats up the material. Whenever phonon is absorbed, it takes the heat from the material. So that's how it works. So in the case of indirect band gap semiconductors, whenever electron is transferring from higher energy level to lower energy level, it gives a heat energy or absorbs the heat energy. It won't radiate any photons. Very less energetic photons may be radiated. So the lifetime of the charge carriers are more because the momentum will not be conserved. So the lifetime of the charge, the carriers will be staying longer time in this case, in the case of indirect band of semiconductors. These are mostly from elemental semiconductors like silicon and germanium. Remember, this is important. Silicon is what semiconductor? Is it a direct band gap or indirect band gap? Silicon and germanium are
both of them are indirect band gap semiconductor. That is the reason why we don't use a silicon and germanium based semiconductor materials to emit light. That means light emission applications, we don't use this kind of silicon and germanium, because they both forms indirect band gap semiconductors, where the light emission cannot be taken, cannot happen, only the heat only will be absorbed or emitted. That means whenever you have electron transition in the case of semiconductors like this, there will be a lot of heat will be generated. These are used to amplify the signals in the transistors and rectifying diodes. So that's the reason why for light emission applications, we always use the materials who has a direct band gap semiconductors. For any other applications like electrical applications like amplification or processing like transistors or rectifiers, we use indirect band gap semiconductors. So that means whenever you wanted to prepare any LEDs, light emitting diodes, laser diodes, we always require a direct band gap semiconductor. So this is about the differences between direct band gap and indirect band gap semiconductors. Thank you so much for your attention.